Hello, this is, I got hair in my mouth again, damn it, I keep doing that. Hello, this is Vision, Eric Musbarnes, and you're watching Skateboarding California. Now, when I first started skating in 1987, skateboarding was all about a California skateboard team called the Bones Brigade, who skated for a company called Powell-Peralta. Now, the important thing to remember is back in 87, we had absolutely no sort of media coverage of skateboarding. We literally had two magazines, Thrasher and Transworld. That was it. Okay, there was no internet, so that means you had no YouTube, you had no Facebook. You didn't have smartphones where you could watch videos on them. You didn't have home videos and DVDs. There were no X Games on ESPN. I mean, if you were interested in skateboarding, you literally had those two magazines and absolutely no other resources to find out about skating. Well, then one day, my friends and I got our hands on one of the videos for the Bones Brigade.
You see, the Bones Brigade videos were the very first skateboarding videos ever created. I mean, finally, we had something other than a magazine to show us skateboarding. So my friends and I mean, we all identified with the Bones Brigade because no other skateboarding companies were making videos. No other companies bothered to showcase any of their riders. So there were other great skaters out there, but we never saw them ride.
From that point on, as far as we were concerned, the Bones Brigade was skateboarding, period. So over the years, I've actually had the chance to skate with members of the Bones Brigade, such as Caballero and Lance Mountain and Mike McGill.
Once the Bones Brigade fell apart, the skateboarding industry never had another team like them. I mean, most skateboarding magazines and companies soon betrayed the culture of skateboarding just to make a quick buck. Selling punk rock anarchy to disenfranchised youth is easy money. By encouraging and perpetuating negative stereotypes of skateboarders and giving coverage and sponsorships to any degenerate scumbag who could do a kickflip, kids were brainwashed to thinking they should emulate and idolize unethical delinquents. Thankfully, skateboarding was preserved and protected by a few decent companies where a more wholesome image of skateboarding was cultivated. Places like the X Games, which promoted skateboarding as a legitimate athletic sport. Now, despite these strides, never again did skateboarding have a team of fun-loving skaters who were positive role models like the Bones Brigade.
Honestly, over the years, I didn't really think that a team like the Bones Brigade would ever exist again.
25 years later, I finally found them. I started skating with an upstanding and respectable group of skaters in California who embodied the same sense of joy and passion for skateboarding that I had admired so much in the Bones Brigade. Here was a group of skaters who weren't skating to be cool or to make a fashion statement or to evangelize a self-destructive lifestyle. These were skaters who sincerely loved skating, dominated contests, and were exemplary role models for the youth.
Those skaters are the girls, the ladies, of Silly Girl Skateboards. Recently, Stacy Peralta, the founder of the Bones Brigade, created a documentary film about the Bones Brigade. I thought it would be kind of cool to do a movie review of that documentary, and I figured who better to do that review with than the female equivalent of the Bones Brigade, the girls of Silly Girl Skateboards.
We got together at the offices of Silly Girl and we checked out the Bones Brigade autobiography. I mean, I really love this film and I'd already seen it about three times, including one of the screenings with Tony Hawk, Mike McGill, and Rodney Mullen. But for many of the girls, this was actually their very first time seeing it.
People, they only see the outcome, but they don't know what really goes into it.
The guys used to spit on Tony back in the day.
It was so discouraging that I was gonna quit.
How in the world could this guy be the world champion and just walk away from it?
My dad, you know, he never wanted me to skate. And he goes, you're going nowhere in life and I'm doing this to save you.
I was miserable at everything I tried to do. I rode a bike, tried to do a wheelie, the front wheel fell off, I crashed. Skateboarding, it was the first time I was good at something.
Not only were they unknown, they were all picked as a very young crew.
When we got into skating, you did not become rich or famous if you were good at skateboarding. No one did, no matter how good you were.
I just remember looking at my arms and the goosebumps. I just witnessed history.
It was the moment where skateboarding became skateboarding.
Hawk just got bigger and bigger every time I came out of jail. I was pushing a shopping cart. Hawk was on a Slurpee cup.
I'm here in representation of thousands of other kids who worship those guys as well and whose lives that those guys changed.
When I started skating, it gave me a sense of identity. It gave me a sense of self-confidence. It gave me a purpose.
Teachers would reach out, is he autistic? Or I don't know. Skateboarding, what it represented, the ability to create, to express myself, it became my voice.
I just look back at my life and I feel so blessed to be a part of this whole scene.
What I think stood out to me the most was how much like everybody like wanted this, like they had this drive.
You know, it was tough at times. I mean, I remember, you know, competing in Texas, throwing up behind the ramp, come back up, oh, I'm good. A couple of kids, you know, saw what was going on.
Why were you throwing up?
I knew if I didn't do well in those contests that I was gonna drift away, and that jungle of Florida that I grew up in trying to skate, you know, and it just wasn't happening. I was gonna follow my dream.
I'm looking forwards and like, I wanna be this good. I wanna be better than these people and I just wanna be the best I can be and I wanna skate as hard as I can. And that stood out to me a lot because I saw all of the obstacles that they went through and it made me think like, you know, like we're not the only ones who, you know, we have to like focus on school. We've got other activities we're in, you know, we're more involved in other things and we can't just skate. Not only can we relate to it, but like just like hearing what they had to say, like it's really inspiring. Yeah.
I relate to like when they're talking about contests and like when they saying that they're kind of burnt out on it because like they're winning every contest. That's like not my situation, winning every contest, but like doing contests, like you get burnt out on it.
This kid had completely kind of collapsed. And Steve did all the talking for him and was telling me, Tony's really disturbed and upset and he feels he can't compete anymore. He doesn't want to compete anymore.
I don't like being judged on style. I don't like being judged on my skating. So I kind of relate to them too because that's how they feel. So like I feel them.
The part that stood out to me the most in the video is the Tony Hawk and Rodney Mullen being at the top of skateboarding and people almost looking like, oh, they're a freak show. But really they were innovating some of the greatest parts of skateboarding that would pave the way for skateboarding for the rest of basically its years. Like they were the founding of skateboarding. How could someone look at that and hate that, you know, and look at that like, oh, look at that person's style. Like, how could you judge someone's style? Like, everyone has a different style, you know?
Tony and Rodney were both outsiders from the beginning. And for a long time, what they were doing was considered odd. They would do it, you would bring your friends to come to the park, see what Tony's doing. Hey, we're gonna come out behind the building, I'll show you what Rodney's doing. And they would go look at that and they go, well, it's like a freak show.
One thing I thought that was cool though is the fact that they talked about how like everybody respected Rodney.
Yeah.
Like even though they didn't like freestylers and stuff necessarily, they thought Rodney's stuff was like really cool.
Freestyle was, you know, small boards, tight shorts.
goofy, total goofy attire. We all hated freestyle. But here came Rodney, and we'd all stop. Everyone would stop. The whole skate park would stop. All the vert skaters would stop.
Everybody would go watch Rodney. Didn't matter, because you knew what you were in for a show.
And I thought that was kind of a neat thing. And I also thought that it was great that Rodney got so much coverage, because honestly, like, with the Bones Brigade, he wasn't featured. Like, you watch Animal Chin.
Nobody liked freestyle, but he was the one. Out of the few, you know, that really could.
Well, and it's like now, it seems to me like now he's more appreciated.
Yeah.
You know, like he's put into this movie.
Totally.
As if he's this really big thing, but like when Animal Chin came out, he doesn't even have a speaking part in that.
Yeah.
You know, he's in it, he's in that party scene, but that's it.
Totally, and like, dude, it's crazy. When I started skateboarding and kids at school found out that like I was a skater and like doing stuff, people would always be like, oh, can you do dark slides? And I'd be like, a dark slide? You mean like a Rodney Mullen trick? And I was like, no, I don't do freestyle, I do pools. But yeah, totally.
The part that stood out to me the most was probably when Mike McGill invented the McTwist.
You couldn't do it below the ramp. You had to commit yourself in a very dangerous position.
You know, it took a lot of courage, because I didn't necessarily do that kind of thing. I mean, of course, you know, I skated as hard as I could, but I didn't take that kind of a risk, but I want to do this. And I just thought, you know what? I'm going to do it.
I just thought it was really cool because he was doing a flip in the air and twisting. So, I don't know, I just really wanted to do it.
Yeah. Well, hey, you're awesome. You're young enough, you can learn it. You know, you can try. You mean like next year, I think?
You are an innovator, like Mike McGill. You could do it. You have
a
fitness behind you.
There you
go. You're strong.
That's very good motivation.
Motivation.
I don't have good vocabulary.
I think Silly Girl relates to Craig Stysik's thoughts, because his ads were about like not the team doing tricks and escape from magazines, but being themselves. And when we do our ads, I don't think I've ever seen a Silly Girl ad where there's like us doing a trick.
Craig was vehemently against ever putting a skateboarding picture in an ad. His philosophy was, let the magazines show skateboarding. We show ideas and images.
Yeah, I mean, to me, that's always been something that kind of stood out, too. Like, the first time Silly Girl started doing that, you know, like that, I immediately thought, these look like Bones Brigade.
Yeah, but I haven't been around since, like, the very beginning, but I've never seen an ad where, like, there's a girl doing, like, a trick on skateboard.
I think what stood out to me the most was that, like, when they were all skating, like, they were never, like, really competitive. It was just a fun competition to push each other. Like, they would wear each other's shirts. And I think that's, like, really cool, because they're, like, they're not having, like, disagreements. They're just having fun when they skate.
And that's what I love about being a part of the Bones Brigade, was just this group collective of skaters that pushed each other to higher levels.
We all rooted for each other. If one of us did well, then everyone else was stoked on it. You know, I remember there was one contest where we all wore each other's shirts as support.
Well, just like members of the Bones Brigade lived all over the country, so do members of Silly Girl Skateboards. So while Julie and Beverly and Shantae were unable to join us, we did get a video sent to us from Natalie offering her opinions on the Bones Brigade autobiography.
Hi,
The most unexpected part in the film was that Lance Mountain really felt like he wasn't good enough and he had to push even harder and harder.
I wasn't very progressive oriented, and when I got on the team, I knew the rest of the guys were like, "Stacy, are you seriously telling us that you're bringing this dude on? Johnny Joke gets last every contest, ruins the contest. You're bringing that onto our thing?"
I didn't see that coming. I thought that he always thought that he was one of the big guys and one of the top guys out there. I didn't know that he struggled with that inside. And so with that struggle, it gives you that force of fire behind you that makes you want to just get better and better until you're learning all kinds of crazy tricks.
I think that the video really relates to kind of like the Silly Girls team, because like, I'm just gonna be honest, and I've never said this in front of Matt or in front of anyone. I don't feel like I am on like a part of the team, and I get jealous of you girls when I see your pictures together and I see your stuff online, and it's like, Silly Girl is like miss all you guys, and I'm not in there, and I'm like, yeah, because I was before you guys or something. And like, I feel like Lance, the outsider who's lucky to be a part of this and emotional and kind of the dumb goof off, kind of like trying to hang in on skateboarding but got my life going on. And I don't know, I love you guys and I get jealous, but like look up to you guys at the same time, and just a positive attitude. And you girls really encourage my skateboarding a lot. Oh my god, Joel.
So, you know, when I first started creating skate videos, I honestly didn't know whether or not anybody would watch them. And I am very proud to say that at this point, I have over 1 million views on the videos I've created, which is actually more than the Powell-Peralta YouTube channel has.
And here is the proof. Powell-Peralta has 1,054,399 views. My Learn to Ride a Skateboard channel has 947,640 views. Skateboarding California has 349,612 views. And finally, California Girl Skateboards has 238,713 views. Now, if you add all three of my channels together, it comes to a grand total of 1,535,965 views, which is a full 500,000 views more, or 50% more, than Powell-Peralta.
And I'm also very proud of the fact that I've been able to include so many female skaters, like the girls of Silly Girl. And it's really great to get a lot of validation from people out there who have sent me emails and told me that they were inspired to start skating because of my videos. And that's really fantastic, because the Bones Brigade inspired me, and I feel really good that now I get to inspire others. So I hope that you go out and purchase the Bones Brigade documentary. And thank you very much to all the girls of Silly Girl who helped me to make this video. See you later.
Bye. Bye, 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 bye.
All right, that's good enough. Let's watch the movie.